Okay, so now we have to learn the kinematics of machinery. There are two methods of velocity analysis. First is the ICR method, instantaneous center of rotation method, and the second is the relative velocity method. I have already covered the instantaneous center of rotation method in my previous lectures. So now I will be focusing on the relative velocity method. First, before starting with the relative velocity method, we must first have an idea exactly what relative velocity is. So in this video, I will be trying to explain what relative velocity itself is. Okay. So first of all, what is velocity? Okay. We all know what velocity is, but just we will take an overview of it once again. So the basic definition is the velocity of an object is the rate of change of its position. This is something that we all know, but the next part is the most important part, which we often forget to include in our definition. That the velocity of an object is the rate of change of its position. That is true, but it is with respect to a frame of reference. For example, see in this case, okay, this is just a simple example. This is a box A. This is a box, sorry. This is a box. It is currently at position A. After 5 seconds, it moves forward to a position B. Okay. So the distance is 10 meters. But how did we measure this distance? We measured this distance with respect to this frame of reference, this XY axis frame of reference. If we do not have this frame of reference, we won't be able to directly measure the distance. Okay. For example, again, it moved from position B to position C. Again, we have the same frame of reference. We are using the same frame of reference for measuring the position of this box. That is why we can definitely say that the velocity is 2 meter per second, because the displacement has taken place in this frame of reference. Okay. So I will again go back and tell you, repeat this. The velocity of an object is the rate of change of its position with respect to a frame of reference. Okay, so in most cases, our frame of reference is the Earth. Okay, so our XY axis is stuck to the Earth itself. As the Earth moves, our XY axis moves. Okay, but it is possible, as we will see afterwards, that the frame of reference can be different. It is not necessary that the frame of reference should always be Earth. Okay, so just a recap of velocity, that velocity is the rate of change of position with respect to a frame of reference. Now, velocity is a vector. What does a vector mean? A vector means that it has both a magnitude and a direction. For example, in this case, see, in both cases, the velocity is in the same direction towards right. But in the first case, because it took it 5 seconds to move 10 meter, its velocity is 2 meter per second. In the second case, it is 5 meter per second. So the vector is much bigger as compared to the first one. Okay. So velocity is a vector. It has magnitude and direction. The length of the arrow, which represents the velocity, is directly proportional to the magnitude. And the direction of arrow represents the direction of velocity. Okay. So this is such an important point that I have written it again over here. Okay, so velocity must be with respect to a frame of reference. Okay, so this was the velocity. Now we are seeing what is relative velocity. Okay, so in case of velocity, we were measuring the velocity with a fixed frame of reference. When we are talking about relative velocity, the relative velocity of an object is the rate of change of position with respect to a frame of reference of a different object. Okay, so in this case, whenever we are talking about relative velocity, we have to take into consideration this, that the object is moving, but we are not measuring its velocity with respect to ground. We are measuring its velocity with respect to another object. Okay, to explain what I mean by this, let us look at this example. Okay, so in this example, there are three things. Okay. First of all, there is a river. The water in the river is flowing at a speed of 5 meter per second. There is a speed boat which has a maximum speed of 10 meter per second. And there is an empty barrel. Okay. So the empty barrel is just going to float in the river. It has no means of propulsion. So it is not going to move at any, or it does not have its own speed. It is going to move at the same velocity as the river itself. Okay. So imagine that there is a person A who is sitting in the boat. There is a person B who is sitting in the barrel, and there is a person C who is sitting on the ground close to the river. Okay, he is sitting on the bank of the river. Now, if I ask you what is the velocity of person A, we will most probably, most of us say that as the speed of the boat is 10 meter per second and the river speed is 5 meter per second. So the velocity of person A is 15 meter per second. This is the most common answer that can be expected. But this might not always be true. For example, if I ask person C, ki what is the velocity of person A? He will say that the velocity of person A is 15 meters per second. But what happens if I ask the person B? Person B, in case of person B himself is moving towards the right at a rate of 5 meters per second. Because the barrel is floating in the river, it is moving along with the river. So person B himself has a velocity of 5 meters per second. So when we ask person B, what is the velocity of person A? The answer that person B is going to give is 10 meters per second. Okay, so this is a slight difference. The person A's velocity is not actually changing, but what is changing is the frame of reference. When we ask person C, the frame of reference is fixed to the ground. But when we ask person B, the frame of reference is itself moving at a velocity of 5 meter per second. Therefore, the velocity of person A with respect to person B is 10 meter per second, but the velocity of person A with respect to person C is 15 meter per second. And if I ask person A himself, imagine that you are sitting on the boat itself and someone asks you what is the velocity of person A with respect to you. You are also on the boat, person A is also on the boat, so with respect to you the velocity of person A is zero. Why? Because your frame of reference, you are moving along with the boat. Your frame of reference is also traveling at a speed of 15 meter per second. Okay. So this is what is relative velocity. In case of relative velocity, we measure the velocity of an object with respect to another object. Okay. So relative velocity depends on two things. It depends on the velocity of the object and it depends on the velocity of the observing object, whether that observing object is moving or not. Okay. So this was a simple example. In this example, as all the vectors were in the same direction, all river, person A, person B, all were moving in the same direction. So the calculation was slightly easier. Okay. So we will move on to another example. Okay, so if we look at this example, see, in this example there are three people again, person A, person B and person C. Person A is standing on ground itself, person B and person C, they are sitting on a seesaw. Okay, at this position, imagine that the seesaw is moving upwards over here, means the seesaw is rotating in a clockwise direction. So person B is going upwards, person C is going downwards. Okay, these are the details, that length of OB from here, center of the seesaw, till the person B. This length is 1 meter. Length from center to person C is also 1 meter. And the angular velocity of the seesaw is 5 radians per second. Okay, so in this question, again, if I ask you what is the velocity of person C, so how will we know exactly what the velocity of person C is? Okay. So this time again, the answer will depend on the person. If we ask person A, he will give us one answer. If we ask person B, he will give us a different answer. Okay. So if we ask person A, with respect to person A, what is happening? The length of the seesaw is 1 meter. The angular velocity is 5 radians per second. So by the formula V is equal to R omega, the velocity will be 1 into 5, that is 5 meter per second. This velocity will be perpendicular to the seesaw in the downward direction. perpendicular to the seesaw in the downward direction. So person A will say that person C is moving with a velocity of 5 meter per second. Okay. But if we ask person B, ki what is the velocity of person C? In this case, the situation is different from the first situation. Why? Because the total length from B to C now becomes 2 meter. B thinks that he is stationary. B does not know that he is moving upwards. When we ask B what is the velocity of C, he always assumes that he himself is stationary. So the total length from B to C becomes 2 meter. The angular velocity of the bar is same, of the seesaw is same, 5 meters per second. So B feels that C is moving with a velocity of 10 meter per second in the downward direction. See, the motion of C has not changed. Motion of C has remained constant. But the observing persons are different. In case of person A, he was on the ground itself. But in case of person B himself is moving. Hence, he himself has some velocity. Hence, the velocity of person C with respect to A is different from the velocity of person C with respect to B. Okay, so this is the important point. From this example, we can conclude one important thing. Okay, in this example, for AC, the velocity of C is perpendicularly downwards. Okay, in this example also, the velocity of C is perpendicularly downwards. It is perpendicular to the seesaw. Okay, so from these two things, we can know that whenever we want to find the velocity of point X with respect to point Y, it is denoted like this, velocity of point X with respect to Y. Okay, that velocity is always perpendicular to the line joining X and Y. For example, in this case, person A is also ground and this center O is also ground. So the velocity is perpendicular to the line joining ground and person C. In this case, the velocity is perpendicular to the line joining B and C. Okay. So now these were some real life examples. Okay. But we are now moving on to another real life example, but which is actually more related to your subject. Okay. So let us look at an example of a mechanism. Okay, so this is the simplest mechanism possible. It is a 4R mechanism. It consists of 4 links. Link 1, which is grounded. Here is link 2, link 3 and link 4. The lengths of the links are given over here. Okay, so imagine that link 2 is rotating with a speed angular velocity of 120 rpm. Link 2 is rotating with an angular velocity of 120 rpm. Okay, so what is the velocity of point B? This is a joint B. If someone asks you what is the velocity of joint B, your answer will depend on your observation. Where are you observing it from? For example, let us look. Okay, let us imagine that we are looking at point B from point A. We are standing at point A and looking at point B. As A is connected to the ground, it has zero velocity because A is connected to the ground itself. It has zero velocity. So the velocity of point B, what will be the velocity of point B? Because A is fixed, B can only perform pure rotation. Hence, its velocity can be given by V is equal to R omega. That is what we have written over here. Velocity of B is length of link 2. This length into angular velocity of link 2. So V is equal to R into omega. From here, we see that length of link 2 is 100 mm. Okay. So substituting that, 100 mm means 0.1 meter. Substituting that length of link over here and omega, angular velocity is given by 2 pi n upon 60, where n is the RPM. RPM is given as 120 RPM. So substituting those values, 0.1 into 2 pi n upon 60. We get a velocity of 1.25 meter per second. That is velocity of B with respect to A. We get velocity of B with respect to A equal to 1.25 meter per second. and this velocity acts in a direction which is perpendicular to the line joining B and A. So it is in this direction of this green arrow. Okay. Now if we look at this link 4, okay, after link 2 we will look at this link 4. In case of link 4 also the case is similar. See, this is the link 4. I will show you the entire diagram. Okay, so we analyze this point. Now we are analyzing point C. Okay, we are analyzing the joint C. Okay, so in case of this example, see, again link 1 is fixed. This is my link 4. I have to find out the velocity of joint C. Okay, so again as D is fixed, this link will perform pure rotation. Because of pure rotation, its velocity will be given by the formula V is equal to R omega. In this case, we know the length of link 4. What is the length of link 4? 150 mm. Okay. So we know the length of link 4, but we do not know the angular velocity of link 4. Hence, we cannot find the magnitude of the velocity of point C. We cannot find the magnitude of velocity of point C. But we always know that whenever we have to find the velocity of one point with respect to another, the velocity is always perpendicular to the line joining those two points. Okay. See, we saw that over here. Whenever we have to find the velocity of point X with respect to point Y, the velocity is always perpendicular to the line joining the two points. Okay. So, if we want to find the velocity of C with respect to D, the velocity will be perpendicular to this line CD. That is, it will be in this direction, in the direction of this green arrow. Okay. We do not know the magnitude, but at least we know the direction. Okay. Okay. So, we found the velocity of B with respect to A and velocity of C with respect to D. But what happens when they ask you to find the velocity of C with respect to B? See, in the first case of B with respect to A, it was easy to find because A was fixed. When finding the velocity of C with respect to D, it was easy to find because D was fixed. But in case of finding the velocity of C with respect to B, it becomes difficult. Why? Because B is also not fixed, C is also not fixed. Both are moving. So how do we find the velocity of C with respect to B? Well, in this case, when both the points are moving, you have to do a simple thing. Okay. See, what we have to do, what is asked, you have to find the velocity of C with respect to B. What is the first thing that you do? You assume the point with respect to whom the velocity is to be measured to be fixed. Means what? In this case, we have to find the velocity of C with respect to B. So assume that the point B is fixed. Okay, just assume that it is fixed. So if point B is fixed, what will be the velocity of C? Well, as B is fixed, this is going to perform pure rotational motion. So velocity of C with respect to B will be what? R omega. So length of BC into angular velocity of BC. Okay, that will be R into omega. So if we assume that B is fixed, we can find the velocity of C. This is velocity of C with respect to B. This is not the actual velocity of C. This is just the velocity of C with respect to B. And in which direction will the velocity be? The velocity will be perpendicular to the line joining the two points. See, we saw in this example itself. If you have to find the velocity of point X with respect to point Y, it will always be perpendicular to the line joining the two points. So, to find the velocity of C with respect to B, where will it be? It will be perpendicular to the line joining the two points. And what will be its magnitude? Its magnitude will be length of BC into angular velocity of BC. Okay. So, these are the three things that I want you to remember after this video. What are the three things? Whenever you want to find the velocity of B with respect to A, the velocity will always be perpendicular to the line joining A and B. If you have to find the velocity of B with respect to A, we have to assume that A is fixed and B is performing pure rotation about it. Hence, velocity of B with respect to A will be given by the formula length of BA into angular velocity of BA. Okay. So, these three points are necessary. In the next video, using these three points, we will see how to draw a velocity diagram. Okay. Thank you.